It's Warren Huart here. Hope you're doing marvellously well. I'm sitting with the wonderful Greg Collins. How are you, mate?
Good. Nice to meet you.
We just were talking, actually, just off camera about Jim Scott.
Yes.
Now, good you man. Started at Ocean Way?
I actually started at Record Plant.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, I worked there for a year.
LA or New York?
Here in LA.
Great.
And that was in 1996.
Great.
Then after a year there, I'd been working there like, you know, 80 hours a week as an assistant.
Sure.
I was getting burned out because a lot of like late like pop sessions and some, you know, all kinds of music. Very cool to be exposed to all kinds of different music, but I wanted to work on more like rock bands and live tracking kind of thing. So Don was doing a session there and I was the assistant, and I was like, just, he could tell I was really into it and stuff. And he was like, man, you should go work at Ocean Way. It's where we track all the live bands usually. So I was like, okay, cool. So
great.
Luckily, a couple good words were put in and I got to go work over there for a few years.
How long were you there for?
About 3.5 years. You know, the whole thing where you try to go freelance and then you're like, yeah, and then you're like, your phone's not ringing. You're like, hey, do you guys need any shifts?
Yeah, exactly.
So, you know, kind of slowly made my way out of there, but it was a great place to be, you know.
And who did you end up working with in those 3-4 years that you were there?
Oh man, lots of cool stuff. Like Red Hot Chili Peppers was one of the great sessions that I worked on with Jim Scott, and myself and another assistant, John Sorensen, were covering. We had two rooms going, and Jim had another commitment, so he had to go leave the session, and he told Rick Rubin, who was producing, he's like, these guys can cover, you know, he can finish the record. So we got to get our first engineering credits on that record, so that kind of helped.
That's amazing.
That was a nice little, yeah, first credit to have. That was Californication.
I remember that album well.
Yeah, good record.
It was a fantastic album.
Yeah.
My old studio, they did the pre-production for it.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. It's interesting seeing that work. I wonder how it worked. I'd love to know. I've never worked in the recording mm-hmm. side with them. Mm-hmm. But I know that they're definitely a band. They're like a real band.
Oh, for sure, yeah.
You know, especially, I wish people could see that these days. Mm-hmm. Of like how guys like that get together in a room and work off each other mm-hmm. and listen to each other and communicate. I was always pretty amazed at just how much of a band they were.
Yeah, it was. I feel so lucky to have been there like during the tracking of all these, hear songs on the radio and I'm like, God, I remember that day and the mood everyone was in and the, you know, the feeling whenever we came in for the playback and listened to it and everyone's just kind of like, yeah, this is the take. And then, you know, you just go in and, you know, we're on tape, of course. So, you know, the idea of like, you know, fixing something is like you have to really, really want to take that chance of punching in on a track.
Sure.
And, you know, because there's always a slight chance that you're going to have a problem punching in or out or whatever. So
it'll never be quite as good as again. You know, like,
yeah.
But the bomb previous.
Yeah. Yeah. And there are that kind of band where there's all kinds of like, you know, you could call them mistakes or whatever, but it's just all part of the vibe.
Yeah, so, definitely.
Really cool.
Yeah, I'm terrible with myself. I know you play guitar as well, mm-hmm. and you've got great collection of guitars. Mm-hmm. But I notice I'm the worst at producing myself.
Oh, it's dreadful. Yeah. I mean, I'll sit there and, you know, just a simple part. And you'll just, because you can, you just keep going like, no. And then do you do what I do, which is where you'll play like, you know, halfway through the song and you'll make some error, like, you know, at the halfway point, you'd be like, oh, fuck it. You just go back.
Yeah.
Just hit the Apple period and dump it and just start from the beginning. It's like just a neurotic.
But you know, if you're producing somebody else, you're like, it's great up to this.
Oh yeah, that's
punch
fine.
That's great. I love it. Yeah. I find when I work with like great session players, for instance, if they're on top or behind, I'm like, wow, what a great feel.
Yeah.
When I do it, I'm out of time.
Yep, exactly.
So yeah, I've learned to try not to be too precious with my own playing. But
it's hard. It's hard to remove yourself.
Yeah, it is. It's easier to be produced than it is to produce yourself, have somebody else do it. So you Californication, mm-hmm. And so that was the first set, major engineering credit. What happened
there?
How did that sort of spark off to where you're at now?
Well, again, that, like you get all excited. You're like, I have an engineering credit.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know,
my life is going to change.
Yeah. Well, actually, I'd also, around that time, maybe it might have been a year before, I had become friends with E from the band The Eels.
Great. Incredibly talented.
Yeah. And we, my roommate at the time was John Bryan, very well-known producer. And he brought me along to an Eels session. And this is right when I kind of had moved to LA and I didn't really know anybody. And he brought me along to a session and we got along and had a lot of fun. And he just, you know, kind of started inviting me back to work with him. And so that second Eels record, Electroshock Blues,
I got to
do some tracking and mixing on that. So those were kind of my first couple credits. And then, you know, I would just work in someone's garage, you know, to anything. I decided, like, okay, whatever it is, I don't care. I'm not going to say no to any kind of work. So, you know, you just try to build, you know, on your experience and that momentum. I think, like, I tell people this, I'm like, no matter what you're doing, if it's not the thing that you are, like, you know, that you envision yourself doing, but it is, it's the thing that you do, just keep doing it, because that momentum somehow pushes you forward, you know?
I agree, and I also think that sort of humility and humbling yourself is great. I remember thinking about Rich Costey, that even when Rich Costey's production career was going crazy, he's still engineering with Rick Rubin.
Yeah.
I remember thinking to myself, here's a guy that could just put his foot down and go, I'm only a producer. But he's engineering other albums between producing Muse albums.
Yeah.
You know, so I always admired that. Yeah. I thought that was like humbling yourself and, you know. And, you know, we get to work with all these different artists and every, no matter who they are, we learn something from it, don't we?
For sure. It's funny, Rich was actually another roommate. this would be a topic of conversation in itself. Is we had this apartment in Miracle Mile, and Brian Kehew, do you know Brian Kehew, wrote the Recording the Beatles book?
Oh, I do, yeah. I met him, yeah.
So one of the most interesting people on earth and one of the nicest. He was a guy, I was introduced to him through a mutual friend when I first moved here, and he was looking for a roommate, and it was him and John Bryan, and I didn't know John Bryan at that point, or, you know, what his talents were, or how crazy, you know, genius he is. So I just kind of, you know, like, cool, I'm this wide-eyed kid, and I moved in, and, like, you know, come to see, like, first of all, the whole apartment's just full of Chamberlains and Mellotrons and synthesizers and stuff, and I was like, holy shit, it's like the greatest thing ever. And so that was an education into itself, and you know, then like a year or two later, we need another roommate because someone had moved out, and John had moved out, and then this new guy, Rich Costey, moves in. So it was like kind of a halfway house for future engineers and producers.
Sure.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. And Brian, actually, it's a beautiful, gigantic, you know, three-bedroom place in Miracle Mile, and Brian still has that apartment to this day.
Oh, he does?
Yeah, and it's just, it's beautiful. He's got it, like, all, like, decked out, like, period 70s stuff everywhere. It's really
does he
cool.
own it?
No, it's actually, it's like a rent control place. It's just
give it up.
Devastatingly cool.
Yeah.
You know, and he'll never get rid of it.
I hear those stories, especially about people in New York with their apartments they've had for 40
years. Yeah, like
years.
A Central Park West apartment for $800.
Yeah, exactly. That's amazing.
Yeah.
So you basically just were surrounded by music.
Yeah, very, very lucky to have, you know, met a lot of like really talented, cool people that were doing interesting things when I landed here. So,
where did you come from originally?
Well, I grew up in upstate New York, Rochester, New York. And I went to college at State University of New York at Fredonia, which has a music production program. And I ended up living in Boston for a couple of years after college and then moving here.
Did you work in any studios in Boston?
I did. I worked at Soundtrack, which is like a kind of a jingle house. It also has a few big studios that run just as studios.
I don't know that. All I know is Q Division.
Yeah, Q Division was right around the corner, and there was a place called One World that had like an old Neve 8038, and it was a really cool place that I was an assistant at too.
Did you ever work at Q Division?
I never did, but I had some friends who worked over there. I've been to that room. And
they have an 8068 on there?
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I did a couple of records there, not a long time ago. Mm. So how was the school experience? Because I know people ask me all the time, because of the way the nature of the business has changed, and there's less of those jobs that we're talking about, you know, where you assist and you put in the hours, you know, hanging out with other engineers and producers and basically absorbing all the information. How was the school? Do you think that was a big part of your development?
For sure it was. There's nothing like being able to, like, you know, have a place to study what you want to do and have, you know, people with experience showing you things. But you never get a full picture of what the real world's going to be like.
Right.
It's funny, actually, one of the things that Brian Keough said to me when I first moved here, he's like, you know, he's like, so what do you want to do? What are you doing? And I'm like, well, I went to school for this and this and this. He's like, yeah, nobody cares. I'm like, what? He's like, yeah. He's like, that's great. And it's, you know, it's cool that you've got that. But when you, you know, go somewhere, that's really not a factor.
Sure.
As far as like your success or whatever. It's a foundation, but nothing can replace, you know, just being around professionals who know what they're doing. And that's kind of a drag that there's not as big a opportunity for people now, because there's not as many commercial studios.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So when I moved here, it was like I had this huge, and you probably remember the big studio menu, mm-hmm. and it was like, you know, 4 pages of tiny print of all the recording studios, and you'd just call them and see, like, you know, bring resumes by, and you know, you could start as a runner or start as an intern or whatever and work your way up. And now that list is probably like half a page.
You know? Sure.
Luckily, there's still Capitol, Conway, you know, Record Plant, places like that.
Sunset.
Exactly. So yeah. That's where I really, like, you have your education and then you have your you know, your real education when you're actually around the real stuff.
Sorry to throw you on the spot. What would you do again now if you think you were doing this again?
I don't know. I might consider just jumping in. I mean, I like the college experience because I liked all the other things that I learned and studied. And
I think given the current climate, what do you think?
Current climate, if I was starting today, it's hard to say because, like I said, there's so fewer opportunities. I mean, I would definitely try to get into a place that was a big place that did tracking and had all that, you know, could expose me to all that stuff again. But there is a whole new world of doing things on your own and, you know, working in the computer, and you know, it's probably more, it might have led me more towards like the sort of, you know, writing and composing side of things, you know, quicker, because you'd just be doing everything on your own and just kind of generating music on your own versus seeking out artists to work with. That might be a different sort of angle that I would take if I were starting out today.
Right.
You know, but
yeah, I get asked all the time, and it's great to meet somebody like you that's sort of in that sort of halfway house, because you started mid-late 90s, just as the industry was kind of...
Yeah, I always say I got on the last bus out of the station, you know, as far as the old way of doing things. You know, at the Record Plant, like, the things I learned how to do were, like, you know, synchronizing 2 analog tape machines, you know, using the remote on a 3348 to fly vocals around. You remember, like, there was a formula, you know, you would take the beats per minute and, you know, calculate with the time code, like, exactly what kind of offset to put in the Lynx modules to fly background vocals. There were guys that would come in that were just absolute whizzes. There were guys that would come in with, like, ADATs and, like, record, you know, stacks of background vocals and then just, like, you know, boom, 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 offsets, fly them.
Right.
And they would take stuff off a 24-track and use an ADAT with the, what was that thing called? Big
BRC.
BRC. Mm-hmm. And they would fly them into the ADAT.
I mean, how did I know that?
Yeah. We all used them. They'd put them in the ADAT and then use that to fly things around. Mm-hmm. There's like,
I was never ready for that.
Yeah. Well, it's like a lost, all this, like, you know, useless knowledge now that I have. Like, I could never apply it now because there's just no use for it.
When Pro Tools came along, I was just like, I just thought it was great because as a guitar player like yourself, I've used MIDI, but it always just seemed like this designed for a different brain. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it seems to me guitar players love Pro Tools because you're able to edit yourself in the way that keyboard players could edit themselves.
For sure, yeah.
I worked with Dave Sardi, and he said to me that he believed all the best Pro Tools editors were guitar players, not keyboard players.
Hmm. I can see that.
Yeah, I think it's just, you know, because we're into... Again, it's contentious, but, you know, Jimmy Page or Jeff Beck, it's like, how late can you be on that note?
Yeah.
You know, where I work with even some of the finest piano players around, I'm sure you do as well. As soon as they get behind MIDI, they just correct themselves perfectly. I'm like, dude, what are you doing?
Yeah. Well, that's like, for me, it was like a remedial keyboardist. You know, someone's like, well, what do you play? I'm like, well, I play, you know, bass and guitar and little drums and then everything else if there's a computer within arm's length.
Yeah, you know. Exactly.
It's kind of sad, actually.
No, it's wonderful. You know, that's also the other great thing about this is that somebody interviewed me the other day and said, made me think, because they said, what do you think about the fact now that everybody has $500,000 worth of equipment for $300?
Yeah. I mean, that's crazy. That's just the way it is.
Because even 2000, you'd walk into a studio, it was $1,500 or $2,000 a day to be in one of these beautiful rooms. Mm-hmm. And they had 8 1176s.
Yeah.
2 Lexicons, like 3 digital delays, but basically like 6 or 7 really nice. So when you're mixing, you could have 6 or 7 multi-effects.
You'd prioritize all the good stuff. You'd be like, okay, I have one Fairchild. Yeah. I'm going to use that. I'm going to use one side on the bass, one side on the lead vocal. 2 1176s, okay, background vocals. You'd have to really sit there for the first, you know, hour of like being in a new studio, be like, okay, how am I going to prioritize using the different good gear they have? Now, it's almost like you feel guilty. You're like, should I put a Fairchild on every channel now? Because I can't. Yeah. Like, I have one here, like a, you know, virtual one. So, yeah, it's a whole
$500,000 of gear just for $300.
Yeah, you know, it's crazy. Yeah,
it completely changes the way we think about stuff.
Totally.
Do you have the UAD stuff? Have you tried that?
I do. I love it.
Yeah.
I love everything except for the latency issue.
Oh, is there a latency issue?
Well, and if you got any secrets on that, I'm
I don't. I'm just getting into UAD. Yeah. I'm a very late arriver. Mm.
Yeah. Just that they introduce, because it's got to go out of Pro Tools and back in, I guess it just introduces a lot more latency than regular, you know, stuff.
Does the delay compensation not deal with it in mixing? Or
it does, but it's like really big. Like,
was there
like to the point where, like, I've gotten to the point where, like, if I'm tracking, if for some reason I try to save the UAD plugins until I'm a mix stage, but invariably you'll be mixing and you're like, oh, I have to put an overdub on.
Right.
So now I just have gotten into the mode of just like, okay, I'm just going to bounce a reference track and then work to that, because, you know, the delay compensation doesn't fully handle the latency with the UA plugins. Again, maybe someone knows.
Yeah, I was about to say, please leave comments and questions below, because
I just
reviewed a baby Focusrite, the little 2i2, and I plugged it in, tried it, and 100 comments. You should have changed the latency and made it better. You know, it's like what I think is important when we talk about stuff is there's no experts.
Right.
Have you ever met an expert that you?
I mean, I know people who know a lot more than me. That's for sure. Most people. So.
Yeah. But I feel like the beauty of what we do is, like, we're all learning. We were just talking about different guitar tones.
Yeah.
We're swapping stories on how to get guitar tones. It's like, there's no experts.
Andrew Sheps is an expert. I've yet to ever stump.
Oh, really?
Andrew Sheps. If I ever have, like, a really hard question, he's my, like, my fail-safe guy. I've yet to be fully stumped.
I'll text him and say, Greg says you're So from now on, I think Rob Snaff always seems to know something.
Uh-huh.
You know, Rob's got like, I think he's like Barisi, I think he's used every piece of equipment. Mm-hmm. Especially like on the weirder consoles. There was a MCI for sale, and I wasn't sure if it was a good one or a bad one. This record was made on it, and that was done. I'm like, how do you know this stuff? Those guys are...
Some guys, they go deep.
Yeah, they go deep.
Yeah.
But that's another thing about what we do. It's like, you didn't wake up one morning at like 16 years old and go, I want to make a lot of money, I should go into music.
Yeah.
We go into music because we absolutely love this.
Yeah. I heard there were like records where I just was so fascinated by the way they sounded and how they sounded different from other records. So, and the two that I can say specifically were Peter Gabriel's So.
Oh, amazing record.
And Paul Simon Graceland. And they both came out like within, I think, a year of each other. And it was around the time where I was like, you know, starting to play music and was getting really interested in it. And those were the two records I just was like, why does this record sound so cool? Like the Graceland record had all this nonlinear reverb and, you know, really kind of bold production kind of choices. And I just kind of was like fascinated, started reading the liner notes, like, what is it? Who's this guy? Who's Kevin Killen? Who's, you know, Daniel Lanois? And then, you know, you just start, that becomes your fascination and you start looking. And it's incredible that it was before the internet. How do we find out anything? How do we, you know, how do we know anything? Like now, I'd just be like, okay, just Google everybody. Back then, it was like you just would go through your record collection, cross reference, be like, oh, this guy did this and this guy did that, and then start to get a sense of like what that person's sort of thing, what he's bringing. You don't really know. You never know what a producer's bringing to something, really.
No, you don't.
Maybe after like an entire career's worth of stuff, you can kind of say, okay, I get aesthetically what they were kind of, you know, known for. But
some of the guys I admire. Don't seem to leave their stamp on it quite so much.
Yeah.
Like John Leckie. Mm-hmm. I've always been a huge fan of his. You know, he's famous for doing the bends, but then he did Cooler Shaker, and he also did the Stone Roses record.
Yeah.
And every single one of those sounds like the band.
Yeah. The bends, I mean, that's...
It's a masterpiece.
Absolutely one of my favorite records.
That's one of my favorite records, for sure. To me, that does it, has it all, because it's an art piece, but it also happens to have five incredible top 10 singles.
Yeah.
And that's what I want. I want it all.
Yeah, there's not a, I mean, it's, you know, it's a Radiohead record, so it's really nothing really wrong with it at all in any way, but there's no, it's like kind of skipper songs on there.
Yeah, no skipper songs. Yeah, it's all just freaking, they're all like High and Dry, Fake Plastic Trees. I mean, it's just like bang, bang, bang. You want another hit? You want, and you want the art? To me, that's like the...
And the sound is just like, you know, it's so raw and aggressive, but somehow just like, it doesn't have any you know, any negatives to it. Just like totally bold and totally, you know, fearless.
What I love about it, listening back to it all these years later, having done 20 years now of doing what we do on the other side of the glass, I listen back to it now. And I used to think it was so much more complicated than it is. And now I put it on, I'm like, there's only two guitars playing, bass and drums.
Yeah.
And like, oh, a little thing came in here. But I used to think of it as this insanely complex.
Yeah.
It's just so well orchestrated, arranged, whatever the right
word
is.
Yeah, it really is. Yeah.
It's just every choice is absolutely fantastic.
Yeah. And all the sonics of it are just really interesting and cool and kind of just different from what was happening at the time, you know.
And going back to your first, you know, engineering credit, that's, I think, what the Chili Peppers do well as well.
Yeah, definitely. Jim Scott, like, had a whole sound that he kind of brought out with the band in that Studio 2 at Ocean Way, or East West Studios it's called now. That was actually the session where I heard what was coming out of the speakers and I looked at what Jim was doing. And it all kind of clicked. It kind of made sense. You know, like whenever I'm getting a kick drum sound, my brain goes back to that moment when I saw Jim like dialing up a kick drum and like, I was like, oh, I get it. Like it was just like this particular way the kick drum was sounding coming out of NS10s. Like that's like my permanent reference in my brain of what I try to go for.
That's
for
fantastic.
Certain kinds of things. And yeah, I think that record definitely stands, you know, will hold up probably for a long time.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's very raw and honest and yeah.
Performance-based.
The songs are great. Yeah, for sure.
Performance-based. So you've got a lot of lovely choice equipment. Let's
Thank
check
you.
It out. Yeah. Yeah, when I was a kid, I wanted to be Paul Kossoff because of that vibrato he had.
Yeah.
You know, and so when Ace said that he wanted to do that song, I was like really excited, you know, and we just tracked the drums in my little tiny room.
They sound great too. I already told you that. I'm like,
thank you. Yeah, little help from
little help on
samples.
Hey, whatever it takes, man. Yeah. The end result sounds fantastic. Yeah. That's cool.
And Matt's a great drummer.
Yeah.
I mean, he really is. And it's, you know, I think Ace just brings that right kind of level of slop that just makes it go.
Yeah.
Because that's what's in the original. It doesn't go da 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 da. It doesn't have that kind of like modern angular kind of attack.
Sure.
So with Ace, he just kind of like, you know, he gets there as late to the chord as you could possibly could before it's out of time, which is the guys we were talking about off camera earlier, Jimmy Page's and the Jeff Beck's. Yeah. That's what they do. They just kind of like, just finally get to the note and it gives it weight.
So cool.
Wasn't it like Andy Wallace, like 90s when Pro Tools started getting prevalent? And he said something in an interview. He said, music is starting to sound really small. Because everything was so in time. Where a hit used to be, grong, it's now kind of grong. It's like we're all so perfect.
Oh man, we could go on forever about how that's changed, you know, the way that music sounds. But
yeah,
it kind of is what it is. You gotta embrace it. But it's great when artists like Ace and Paul. Kiss and yeah, people like that to just, you know, go au naturel and just, you know, play and we don't chop everything up. It still has a special vibe to it.
So we did a song together, Paul Stanley's song with Ace on Fire and Water, which is why we're talking about it. Mm-hmm. What was Paul's process though on coming out, changing the melody but still having this, it was really smart.
Well, he's really familiar with the song as well. Like I didn't know the song. I mean, I love Bad Company and Free, and I love Paul Rodgers, but I'm not deep on their whole thing. But Paul like knew the song to the point where he didn't really even have to like look at lyrics when he first was singing it down. So I think it was just him kind of making it his own and putting it like in his comfort, you know, range. And
sure.
But yeah, it seemed like a natural.
It does
tune
sound
for him,
really
you
natural.
Know? Yeah.
And we were just saying, turns around and like from conception of idea, I think it was like 4 to 5 days from beginning to end.
Yeah.
It was really cool because they were talking, they were texting, like, oh yeah, let's do a song together. And Ace was like, well, what about this? And Paul's like, I love that song. Boom. It was like, we were tracking drums, putting down a rhythm guitar. I think didn't Paul sing without bass? Did we give you the bass or not?
No, I think there was bass in there.
Oh, okay,
but
cool.
There was, I don't think the whole guitar solo wasn't in there.
It might have been a temp bass.
Probably.
Might have been.
The solo was different for sure. It was like a temp solo.
Yeah, I think we had a temp solo, and I think we had Ace's bass line. And then he went back to San Diego like that same night and had Chris Wise was actually staying with him, and Chris played bass on it. But yeah, I think you guys tracked it to a lot of temp stuff, so that's pretty awesome.
Yeah.
And that's good old fashioned, old school.
For sure.
I like that.
It came out great though.
It was amazing. Yeah. It's one of the best vocals, if not the best vocal on the whole album. No disrespect to Ace, but I'm sure he'd probably actually be fine to admit that.
Are the rest of the tracks him singing, or he's got other guest vocalists?
He's singing. His drummer, in all fairness, Scott, is an amazing singer.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, he does all the Robert Plant stuff.
So, oh, nice.
So all the screaming and the high stuff is done by Scott, who's a great singer.
Oh, great.
Ace is a smart guy, and he's self-effacing. You know, he knows he knows that he's a guitar player who sings, and so he gets other people to sing. You know?
I like Ace's voice.
So do I.
You know, when I was a kid and a Kiss fan, and you know, I was always psyched when Ace would sing a song on the record. You know, just had a kind of like certain. He kind of to me, he sounds a little bit like Lou Reed, like with a little higher pitched voice. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Just his kind of speaky, kind of delivery.
Yeah, the New York comes out in it.
Yeah.
Yeah, you got that kind of like, ah. It's like all the fans do, don't they?
Yeah.
It's like, ah. Which I found out is from the Park movie, Phantom of the Park.
Phantom of the Park, yeah.
Phantom of the Park, where his only words are, ah.
Yeah.
I didn't know that. I still haven't seen it. Have you seen it, I presume?
Oh, my God, yeah.
Hundreds of times.
Many times, yeah. Right. Well, you got to go watch the Scooby-Doo, Kiss Meet Scooby-Doo.
We did the
score for last year, Jared Faber and I. Did all the, like underscore, and then there's like 5 Kiss songs in it, but it's kind of what Phantom of the Park should have been, but it's because of Scooby-Doo and they're at an amusement park and it's like kind of the same exact premise, but you know, animated, and it's really funny, and all the guys do their voices. Doc McGee, their manager, actually steals the whole show because he's fucking hilarious and
really,
and he's just he kind of is a cartoon character, so
it's great. Rock and roll as fun.
Yeah.
Who would have thunk it?
Exactly.
Yeah,
right?
Good stuff. All right, let's go back to these. Let's go back to the gear.
All right.
So the bassman, are you using it for bass or using it on guitars?
Guitar.
Great.
It's a 66, I believe. Someone will correct me. It might be a 68. I forget. Whatever year has this little.
Right.
They call it a drip edge.
I'm not an expert either.
So. Yeah. So it's the same as a black face, but it's got the silver panel.
Right.
And it just. Great sounding, you know, distortion, and like one channel's got the tone knobs bypassed, so it's, you know,
just
got a certain sound, and then
the 800,
you know, classic awesome Marshall, you know, 90s.
Sound of the 80s.
Yeah,
I mean, that was when I was growing up, that was like every record.
Yeah And then this is like one of those like pieces of gear that belongs to a friend that lives at your studio. I'm sure you have some of that stuff.
I have quite a few of those things. Let's just say,
This belongs to the band American Hi-Fi, so that just lives here.
Awesome.
Jamie Aronson, guitar player.
Have you done stuff with American Hi-Fi?
I did some mixing on they just put out a record, but the one before that, I mixed a couple songs for them, but they're good friends of mine.
Perfect. And then the Buddha we were just talking about.
Yeah.
It's special because the panel's upside down.
Exactly. It's just in the wrong, you know, this isn't the original casing.
Oh, I see.
So, yeah, but that's actually my favorite amp. It just has an incredible sound to it. It's got a really good reverb tank, and it's, yeah, it's beautiful. It's got a good amount of headroom, so it's good. It's a good clean amp with the reverb, but then when you crank it up, it has kind of an AC30 kind of sound to it. I guess they, this company is owned by PV now, and they, you know, like usually happens, they mass produce them, and they're not as good anymore for some reason. So,
right.
But that one is, it's like the Millennium Falcon amp. It just looks like a piece of shit, but it sounds great.
Right. I like that analogy. I might steal it. what's Paul's go-to amp when he's tracking?
He uses Engels.
Engels.
With
an E. Okay.
E-N-G-L-E. Yeah. So he's got that. And the last couple of records, we actually used this and his Engel.
Nice one. Great.
Just like recording them both at the same time with a splitter. And Tommy Thayer has Hughes and Kettner amps, like his own signature.
Right.
Hughes and Kettner. So we use that. I like to like record their amps and then, you know, another classic. So we'll use like an old Marshall or something else along with the new.
Are you getting a DI in case you want to reamp as well?
Yeah. Yeah. When possible, when it's, you know, when it makes sense to do that, I'll do that.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes for the solos, especially because we might want to tweak the sound on that.
Yeah. It's nice to have a little extra gain.
Yeah.
And, yeah. I find these days I'm blending DI. Yeah. You know, in-box distortion with live stuff all the time.
I mean, I try to always keep things simple on the tracking side so that it creates fewer, like, there's nothing worse than, and tell me if this is true for you, when you get tracks to mix, you'll get like 8 tracks of like different amps and mics.
Those are all slightly out of phase of each other.
Yeah, and it's a jigsaw puzzle.
Yeah.
And you'll get a rough mix and you won't have really know like, well, what were they using? Because I like the sound. You might like the sound of the balance of the mics on the rough mix. So I'm always like, I try to tell people, just give me, bounce it down to 1 track or 2 if you must, you know, give me 2. But
or tell me the one you favored.
Yeah. But it's just, it kind of creates, you know, unnecessary like head scratching for the mixer. You want to give them something that's kind of start from a point that you know you like, and then let's take it a step further versus giving me the jigsaw pieces and making me put together and get it to the point that you had it and then move it forward. It just is a big waste of time.
Yeah, Chris at CLA was saying that he feels like sometimes, he didn't say it specifically, but he kind of employed sometimes it feels like it's production because they're like, we have no idea. Here's so many different parts.
For sure. I mean, it does becomes a bigger job.
Yeah.
You know, without doubt.
Less commitment, I think.
Yeah.
The one I find, though, is I usually, if I do end up picking a guitar and I go back and say I use this amp, they're like, oh, yeah, that was a 57 on a Marshall.
Yeah, there you go.
It's like, not all the time, but it's the highest odds.
Yeah.
It's usually, and I think it's just, it's almost like snare drums. Mm-hmm. If somebody gives you a snare you like, I'd say 75% of the time it's a Ludwig snare of a 57 on it.
Exactly. Yeah, it's a Black Beauty or a Superphonic or something, yeah.
Because that's the sound of the Beatles and the Bonham and all the guys you grew up listening to. And like, that's the sound of a snare drum.
Yeah, I don't have like a bunch. I have like 4 snare drums maybe. And like 90% of the time, it's the Superphonic.
Yeah, same.
Ludwig Superphonic.
Yeah. I've had
that
snare.
You want it tuned high and open, or you want it low and kind of, you know,
absolutely.
Fleetwood Mackey sounding, yeah.
Yep, it does. Absolutely. Yeah. Okay, so your IOs, you've got a lot of Apogee stuff up there.
Yeah, using the AD and DA16s, which, you know, still sound great. I know that the new HDIOs are supposed to be comparable, but luckily there's a software you can download to make these get recognized by Pro Tools as an HDIO. So keeping those around for now.
Yeah, I have 192s as well, and I actually haven't. I have a AD 8000 SC. I can only go to 48K.
Yeah.
I just love the way it sounds.
You know, Jeff Terzo, who is the overstayer equipment,
hip to that stuff. Fantastic.
Okay, so he did a shootout, or he was a part of a shootout where they took every interface, and he swears that the ones that beat everything and, like, you know, the highest high-end stuff were these 192s.
Right.
Yeah, when people were just blind listening,
sure.
He said that they won. So, you know, the way I look at it is, like, there's records that are, like, incredible sounding to me that were done with 888s, that were done with, you know, Mitsubishi 32 tracks, that were done with, like, ADATs. So I'm not someone who likes to obsess too much about the kind of minutia of this versus that when you've got like two different high-end, you know, like AD converters or whatever. Like, I know there's a difference in it, and it can accumulate, you know, over like the amount of stuff that you're using. But I like to just get like stuff, like when it comes to that kind of hardware, I like to just know that it's the top pro quality and then just leave it at that and worry about right. the music going into it. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I agree.
But
I think we can, we've all done it. I've yeah. done it. We get a little carried away on that stuff.
Yeah. I mean, back in the day, like we're talking about like earlier days of Pro Tools, I remember, you know, we would spend whole days of people just rolling in, you know, the new like DB technologies, A to D converters, and sit sure. there and like do a completely unscientific, you know, listening comparison
right.
that, you know, really was just, you think about it like, wow, I can't believe we had time to just waste doing that. But,
right.
you know, end of the day, I just like, when I know something works, I'd like to just leave that and focus on what's going in.
Right.
Yeah.
I spoke to the guys, Barry over at Radar. I don't use Radar, but he was telling me about it. And he said, you know, we all use the same chip.
Yeah.
It's all the
But those are
stuff
known to
around.
Be the best sounding
yeah.
A to Ds. People put those in front of their, you know, their 192s and go in digitally, yeah.
yeah. But he says it's all the stuff around it.
Yeah.
It's the, you know, the transformers, what, mm-hmm. how, or, you know, if it's discrete electronics, blah, yeah. blah, blah, all this stuff. All the stuff is above my head.
Sure. And you can get into like, you know, those expensive, gigantic, thick power cables on everything. Like, there's
right.
people who swear by that.
Dave Pizzardo talked about power.
Yeah, and there, and I have seen some demos where it was like, okay, well, that there is a difference there.
Right.
But again,
smart enough.
But again, you go back, yeah, but then you go back to, like, you know, records that were recorded without that stuff, and you're like, well, that, you know.
Yeah.
You know, there's got to be a point at which you just kind of, like, not think about certain things
sure.
that are going on,
yeah.
you know, in the background.
Well, Tommy Vaccari, he made the first Prince record. Mm-hmm. He did George Duke. He's got Billy Preston in his 70s.
Mm-hmm.
So he's got this career where he was talking about watching digital come in the 80s.
Mm-hmm.
And he said that people come to him and say, oh, it sounds so harsh. And he's like, yeah, but you've got to stop EQing like you're going to tape.
Right.
That's as dumb as that. Because yeah. So I used to go boost top, because you're hitting tape and it was coming back duller.
Right.
You know, and you were bouncing, so you had to boost the top when you bounce to a bounce yeah. to bounce.
I'm sure that's a big contributor as to why yeah. that's the perception
yeah.
of digital, for sure, at yeah. that time.
Definitely. Well, wonderful stuff. Cool. Are you using this for different speaker selections and stuff?
That's actually just for, I was using that for the Mac. It has a digital in, like optical, so the Mac audio comes in there, and
yep.
then I can select it as a source over here on my monitor controller. So just, you know, and then I've got, you know, the CD players going in there. So it's kind of like a little
God bless CD players.
Yeah, right? this is just because I don't feel like it's a studio unless you have a Panasonic DAT player in the rack. Hasn't been turned on probably in like a year.
Christopher Thorne, you know Christopher
yep.
from Blind Melon,
yeah.
told me that he went back to his DAT tapes from the 90s and they don't play.
That can happen. Like they get all...
Yeah.
Yeah. Because, I mean, I have a whole that closet full of DATs of, like, cool rough mixes and demos and,
yeah.
you know, all kinds of stuff going back 25 years.
Wow.
But, you know, so you keep it around for that. But I bet, yeah, if I put a DAT in there right now, who knows if it would even work.
That's so sad.
Because
they
got dirty,
forever.
Yeah.
We thought they were going to last forever.
Yeah.
Because they're digital.
yeah.
I don't know this. I've never seen this. What's the bus boy?
This is kind of like I haven't really seen them around. It was... brought in by Rob Dickinson from Catherine Wheel. He had a friend who was building these, and it's basically an SSL clone. And it's a good one, it sounds cool. I've used it like as a compressor on piano and stuff like that. And,
great.
And it's good, just a nice SSL clone.
And so this is, Anthony is doing,
Anthony DeMaria,
doing
yeah.
stuff with PreSonus. I didn't know about this.
Yeah, this is just a tube, stereo tube preamp, and it actually has some good, like the impedance switch here, which is kind of cool.
Very small,
for ribbon
yeah.
mics.
Yeah, great.
And it works as a good DI. It's kind of a, you know, it's my extra pair of DIs in the control room.
Absolutely.
I've got a keyboard player over here.
He came down into a session, a record I was making, and lent us some stuff. He's one of the sweetest guys ever.
Oh, he couldn't be nicer, yeah. Really cool guy.
Deserves all the success in the world, yeah. Great guy.
And then this is like, you know, just Universal Audio's tube mic pre.
I don't know this.
Four channel with the cool thing about that is it has digital outs.
That's very cool.
So if I'm running, you know, with a lot of inputs, I can use that guy. I don't have to use up, you know, analog inputs.
That's great.
So going digitally, and again, it's got the DIs. If I've got a big keyboard rig going over here, I can just pop right into that.
Great. So it's great for things like keys and stuff where you want to add a bit of warmth, et cetera, to it.
Yeah, you can drive it a little bit.
Drive,
it's a pretty usable, you know, piece of gear. This is one of the first things I acquired when I started getting my own gear before I even had a studio. You know, it's just got an 1176 in the box with a 610 style mic pre. They're great.
What do you mainly use it on?
This guy pretty much is my mono overhead, just dedicated to that.
Coles, yeah.
Yep. So that's you know, it just works great.
And then Distressor, probably the most usable compressor ever made.
Fantastic, yeah. Especially on snare drum.
Yeah, just does everything, doesn't it?
I do, and this is another thing that I kind of picked up from Jim Scott, is when I'm tracking, I'll mult the snare. Mm-hmm. Jim actually used to take the kick and snare, probably still does, and pumps them through a Fairchild and puts that on its own track.
So I
started doing the same thing, and it just evolved into, I do it on just the snare, and I just do a parallel snare track, smashing it with this guy.
Great.
I'll hit the Pultec style EQ. I'll hit this and then the Pultec style EQ.
Wonderful.
And that's my like color sound for the snare.
I've got to try that.
Yep. You know, reissue 1176.
I have a reissue too.
Standard guy with, you know, I smashed the top and bottom buttons. And that's on the American mic.
Oh.
Do you know about the American mics?
I don't.
Oh, okay. Cool. I'll show it to you. It's a really cool, it's the coolest looking mic for sure that I have. And it's a John Bryan trick. I think he used it for Fiona Apple for her first record. The song Criminal.
Yeah.
Apparently it's just this American mic and a kick mic. Like that's the drum sound. It's just a really notchy, not a lot of high end, not a lot of low, really kind of cool, crunchy mid-range. And when you smash it, it's just got that interesting, cool vibe.
Yeah, so it's a great drum sound.
Lives on that. And this is another Anthony DiMaria, like a LA-2A style compressor. Basically just use it like an LA-2A on vocals. I have like two vocal chains going that I just leave set up.
Right.
An SM7 and then a Bach 251. And it just kind of, you know, and then when I'm doing drums, I just open it up and it's my extra room mic.
Wonderful.
Yeah. I like having things, that the whole idea is to have things that I can just leave dedicated and set up for that, you know, purpose.
So you can move quickly and
exactly
given budgets and having to do a lot of work. Yeah.
Yeah.
Definitely.
This has become kind of just a rack filler, but you know, classic, the 900 series rack.
Every studio DSer, I used to work in used to have.
Couldn't have a studio without the 903 DSer.
But of course now in the box, DSing's so easy.
It's ridiculous.
Plus we could just go in there and draw stuff out.
Tweak it if you want, This I love.
Focusrite, yeah.
Another one of the first pieces of gear I had, and it's become just my bass mic pre. I like it for bass DI. Just kind of has a particular sound that I like a lot. And my bass chain is just basically I go into here, which is a Sans Amp RBI, and then it has a parallel out, which I go into the Focusrite. So I only have to plug into one spot. If there's a guy in here playing bass, he plugs in and I've got both inputs going.
Great.
And then I'll mult that with the radial pedal out to an amp.
Fantastic.
And then that all just kind of.
So what's the difference between the two Sans Amps?
Well, this one's the original. And it's got the classic Sans Amp, you know, drive, crunch, punch, all that stuff. And it's got, you know, memory locations to save sounds.
Oh, I see.
This one was kind of like afterward, came out as just like a bass specific Sans Amp. And it doesn't have memory, so it's a little bit less expensive. But it has, it does add like a sort of thick lower octave to the DI that makes it sound like an amp a little bit. Sometimes, you know, that
is this your preferred one, or you just whatever?
Yeah. Yeah. I love it.
That's great. So that's
nice. That rack.
Now we came as one of the first things that caught my eye was in the Inwood Connections.
Yeah. It's Steve Furlott, who's known gear designer, designed this. He does stuff for Tree Audio, I believe, as well. This was like, I think, his first company. He made vac rack, the compressor, vac rack compressor, and mic pre. So it's kind of, to me, I think it looks like it's based on the 610
universal audio.
It does, yes.
But it has a ton more headroom, so it really is usable on drums. Like you can, and they just have a big size to them. Everything you put through them. Yeah, and they're great. They've got everything, you know, phase and a couple of pads and just a little bit of EQ, that top and bottom.
Great.
Just really, really good.
Oh, so you really have the 312s here we were just talking about for guitar sounds?
Yep. You know, classic. The Shadow Hills, Mono Gammas. These are my vocal chain mic pre's.
Oh, so
these,
I see.
These guys go into the Demaria LA-2A style compressors and just live that way. Just a regular old 512 mic pre ends up being my, you know, if I need something in the control room quickly, plug into that
guy. What's your guitar? Is it the 312 here?
Yeah, so for guitars, I usually end up putting 3 mics on the guitar amp.
Right.
I should probably just go back to using 157 after hearing that guitar sound you got. But yeah, I'll usually do a 57, a Royer, and a 414.
Right.
Because that's what Ed Journey did, and I would assist him, and I'd be like, wow, he gets great guitar sounds.
That's how you do it, I guess. Yeah.
So I'll use this guy, and then this Overstayer stuff, I was talking about Jeff Turzo.
Yeah.
He's great gear designer, great
guy. People love him. You, Joe, yep. Gerisi loves him. His name keeps coming up.
Bob
Horn.
He didn't even design gear. When I met him, he was, you know, keyboard player, programmer, musician, had a band called God Lives Underwater. And, you know, he just really smart guy, and he loved gear, and he was like, I'm going to start building gear, like as a hobby. And I remember his first, like, I have a bunch of his prototypes, the first things he ever made.
Yep.
And these are like kind of the first production models he did, the black, you know, fronted ones. And then he started, you know, his company's grown, and now the stuff looks like it's, you know, super
fantastic.
Pro. But yeah, his mic pre's are, I believe they're kind of similar in design to Shadow Hills. That's like a kind of starting point. And then this is my favorite because it has just, for EQ, it just has a tone knob.
I love that.
You know, more or less. I love things like that.
Me too. I'm dumb. Yeah. I'm not that smart.
Built. it's got a compressor,
yeah.
And you know that's really cool with a, you know, variable attack and release on switches, which I love.
Fast and slow. God bless it.
Yep. And it's just great sounding mic pre. It's fantastic on the Royer. So you know, you crank that tone up a little bit on the Royer, gives you a little bit of that top back.
Wonderful.
And then I'll use this just regular old Focusrite ISA on the. On one of the other mics, 414 or the. I also use the PR30 Heil mic instead of a 57 sometimes.
Those are really nice. Yeah. And then what are these couple of things here? What's the
BAC? So yeah, this I demoed from Westlake. They gave me this to try out, and I love it because it's got the same parameters as an 1176, and it reacts kind of in the same way, and it sounds great on the bass DI. So that guy lives just on the bass DI. It's called a Pete's Place. BAC compressor.
Nice.
And then radial reamper.
Yeah, those
so we
are
take
great.
Our DI signals, put them back out through amps. And then this is a A-Designs, it's called EMP EQ. It's basically the frequencies of a Pultec. It doesn't have quite the crunchiness of a Pultec. It's a little cleaner, but it's great on a snare drum.
Wonderful.
So that's my color mic hitting the distressor and then hitting that.
Wonderful.
And then
Crane song there.
Yep, classic.
That's
monitor controller.
And then we've got the Neve.
Yeah, this guy is my newest acquisition, and I love it. It's a Class AB from the late 70s or early 80s. It's called a 5432, and it's just a Neve broadcast console. And for some reason, it makes the drums sound like Fleetwood Mac right away. So that's why I love it.
Yeah.
It's got really simple, just top bottom EQ with a switchable, like two frequencies for the mid-range. But it's just got a super fat,
wonderful.
Just nice sound to it.
What are the frequencies in the mid? 1/8 and 8/20?
Yeah, I think the bottom's fixed. This is actually a filter we figured out. It looks like, it's kind of confusing because that looks like it's selecting frequencies for the low end, but these are actually high pass filters.
Oh,
down
right.
is 150, that's 82, and that's 47. So that's just cutting.
Perfect.
This is fixed at like 40 or 60 or something. And then the mid-range, you've got 820,
3.9 or 1.8.
Oh, that's just three selections. That's
And then the top is fixed at 10, I think.
So it's all kind of usable.
Yeah,
I mean, that's, there's your kick and
You can't scoop with it, but the thing about this is that it, I find I don't need to do any scooping with it.
Right. It just sounds good off the bat.
Yeah, and I've actually been using it on the mixing side. So I've got this passive summing matrix that Jeff Terzo built, and it needs a amplifier to act as the gain stage for the summing. So what I've been doing is just coming out of that summing matrix into the mic pre's right here. And so that makes up the gain. So that's my main, like, I'll have 16 outputs coming in here. And then I'll do a parallel compression for the drums and bring that up on another pair of channels. And then that'll be hitting an SSL style compressor that Jeff designed. It's got a little bit of, it's the great thing about this is that it's got a blend knob. So it's kind of like having a parallel compressor
that's
there.
Fantastic.
And then there's a nice, just gentle top and bottom EQ that's on there too.
Oh, that's fantastic.
And that's my mix chain. I'm taking the time to go out of the box.
Yeah.
Which, as you know, is like, do I do that or do I not? Because it changes so many things. You can't
recallability.
Recallability, you can't offline bounce. Yep. So you gotta have more time if you're gonna do it that way. But it gives you back a little bit more of that sort of depth and width that you get, in the analog world.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I would say, again, we'll go back to Andrew Sheps, you were talking about earlier.
Yeah.
And Neil Avril, they're both mixing almost entirely in the box.
Yeah.
Neil did the whole 21 Pilots record, which is huge, all in the box. And I really subscribe to it, and I'm sure you're going to agree.
Yeah.
The bottom line is if you're putting it in with a crap load of tubes and, more importantly, transformers and discrete electronics in nice rooms with really good gear, you can get away with mixing in the box quite easily.
Yeah, for sure. The thing that can be a trap, though, is when you're mixing in the box, and this has been my experience, is you can start to try to build the equivalent of what your analog setup is in the box. Like, so you've got your SSL compressor on there and all the stuff on your buses, and you've got parallel stuff going. There's a tendency, at least for me, where I'll lose some of the width and punch, in the box. And I think it's just more a function of thinking about it, thinking that it's gonna react dynamically the same way as it would in the analog realm. Because I think in the analog realm, peaks and things are just getting through and hitting things that just aren't gonna happen in the digital side. So that's always a challenge for me, is getting that size and depth. So I think the way I combat that is to try not to do as much sort of bus, compression and tweaking, because you can, obviously it's so tempting to just slap, the brick wall stuff and start pinning it and all your multiband, trickery, stuff on there. And, because in the other challenge, you get these rough mixes that have been slammed with something that has a vibe and a sound, and you're like, well, okay, now I gotta my mix has to compete with that particular aspect of that, of the rough mix. So,
I'm personally a little afraid of using too much multiband, because I think, because that's a way you can make anything loud.
You can get addicted to it, because it's a cheap way to get.
And you fall into it, you think it's fantastic, and then you come back the next day and your mix sounds so soft.
Yeah.
Because everything's just been sucked in and everything's just bleh.
Yeah.
But it's loud.
Yeah.
Wonderful. So monitors.
Yeah. Okay. So my main near field monitors are the ATCs.
Great.
Which I made the mistake of borrowing my friend Paul Hager's ATCs and falling in love with them, and then finding out how much they cost after. Because I was using Dynaudios, and they were, they're great monitors, but I was doing some pretty hard rock records. I was doing a Kiss record at the time, and those can get a little fatiguey when you're blasting them. The beauty of them is that at really low volumes, they're really even, and I mix so much quieter now since I've gotten these speakers, and that is a total blessing.
Yeah.
So I love them for that reason alone, but they also sound great when you crank them up. Incredible amount of detail in the stereo image and all that stuff. So I can't.
And then a good old-fashioned NS10s on top?
Yeah, with a Macintosh solid state amp, makes a big difference.
Macintosh, right, great. And we were talking earlier about mixing in 5.1, and you went out and bought a home 5.1.
Yeah, a home 5.1 system, which I was like very pleased to find out that if you just take an HDMI cable out of your monitor output of your Mac, you can select the HDMI as your playback engine and have access to a 5.1 output so you can monitor your mix that way. It's
so you mix in really stereo, cool. Get your mix where you want it, and then stem it and start panning it around.
Yeah.
It's perfect.
I think I may experiment with the next project that I do in 5.1, like a concert or whatever, in starting in the 5.1 and then going back the other direction and taking that and making the stereo from that.
I wonder how that would be.
I mean, and not, and I don't mean like folding it in. I just mean by using that as my starting point, my reference. Because usually I get the stereo mix where I really love it, and then trying to make the 5.1 have that impact of the stereo mix is the challenge. So now if I maybe start with the 5.1 and get that sounding how I like it and go backwards, we'll see.
Amazing. Well, let's check out the live room.
Sure. So this is a ISO booth. I keep all the guitar amp cabinets in here, obviously, and the combo amps. So this is a 68 Princeton, same idea as the other one. It's the year that the blackface circuit is in there with a silver panel. And that's great because they're more affordable than the black ones. So.
Oh, they are? Good
tip. But they sound
maybe not after this video.
Yeah, right. Well, so this one has been modified, or not modified, but just refurbished, I should say, by Bob Dixon, who's like a fantastic amp guy.
Yeah, he's the best.
Does all of the, like Mike Campbell and Edge and people like that.
Everybody said.
Yeah. So, just for variety, I keep, this is a Alnico open back 12-inch speaker that actually sounds great paired with that amp. And then just a pair of Celestion Vintage 30s and a closed back 212.
Great. On the open back, do you have a mic on the back as well?
You know, I haven't done that in a long time. But I know it can be a cool sound.
I got that from Dave Jordan. Mm-hmm. That was his kind of Alice in Chains big guitar sound. Part of it was the front and back mic, flipping the polarity of the face and the back. Yeah.
Yeah. And then just a 412 with vintage 30s as well.
So your combination here is the Royer and
the Royer and the PR30 and then the 414 sometimes. Sometimes just one mic will just sound perfect to the other, but I try to blend them, you know, get the sound that I like and blend them to one track, you know.
Great.
So that's, and the other thing I forgot to say about Jeff Turzo's Overstayer mic pre there is that it's got, it's a two-channel mic pre, and then there's a sum out output, so you can blend those two together. So
it's very small.
Yeah, so I'll put the 57 and the Royer into each side of that.
That's so good.
And then
good.
Go to one channel, and I'll just use the input gains as my, or the output rather, as my balance.
Which is great for us now, you know, and guys don't have massive consoles.
Yeah.
Bring everything back in from line inputs and then bus and so on.
That's the big thing I miss about not having the SSL anymore is that, you know, snare mics, kick drum mics, I love to just blend those to one track, you know, and now having those, I told Jeff, I'm like, make me a three channel for my three, snare mics, two top, one bottom, that I can just bang that all to one track, you know?
Great.
So hopefully I'll get that made sometimes.
People are singing his praises like crazy. Yeah. Well, fantastic. Yeah. What else you got going on here? What's this thing?
Oh, that's just a little Hughes and Kettner. This was actually a gift from Tommy, from KISS, Tommy Thayer.
Nice.
He's got Hughes and Kettner amps with his name and his logo on it.
Oh, I see.
But, this is like a little mini version, and it works good as a bass DI, actually.
I've used it
a couple times. Yeah, it's like a 1.5-watt amp. All the companies are making these little like mini amps now.
I've seen the orange little terrace.
Yeah, so it's actually a pretty good sounding little amp. I also keep the Leslie speaker in here.
Oh, nice.
Which is great. I've got a Trek pedal, which allows you to plug guitar straight into it.
Oh, yeah, those are great.
So,
fantastic.
That guy lives in here, and then this mic is an SM2, which is a old Neumann mic, stereo, basically a stereo KM56.
Yeah, I have a KM56.
Yeah, so this is like
stereo.
This is like two of those, and it's one of my best mics.
I was about to say you can use it on acoustic guitars.
Use it on everything. Yeah. But it's fantastic, especially just as a stereo mic on the Leslie.
Oh, fantastic.
Yeah.
Beautiful Gibson there.
Yeah.
Is that a hummingbird?
It's a It's a country and western.
Oh, country and western.
Yeah, same size as those, but without like too fancy inlays and stuff. But it's
beautiful.
Yeah, it's beautiful. Actually, I've got a borrower hummingbird over here.
Oh yeah.
That's
my gorgeous. Friend
Joe Geezy's. I just borrowed this because it has a pickup, and I'm going to be playing a show. So.
Wow. This looks quite valuable.
Yeah, it's a beautiful guitar.
That's gorgeous.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You play Dust in the Wind, man.
I love the neck on this. It's like a Les Paul.
Yeah.
It's like it's great about some Gibsons is they just kind of feel like the acoustics feel like electric necks.
Yeah, I love the necks on those.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
So we got in here the live room. It's small for sure, but yep.
So is mine, so I hear you.
I've gotten so used to this room and figured out how to get a lot of different sounds in here. I can actually make it sound a lot bigger than it looks.
Nice collection of mics here. Very thanks. Eclectic. What, yeah. But I don't know what this is. Can I ask you what that is?
Yeah, that's the Lawson. It's basically like a 47 FET design. And they sell them as a pair. Like there's another one over here. That's the Tube 47 body with a 47 capsule. And this has a 251 style capsule on it.
Oh, look at you. I love these.
Yeah.
I had a pair and they've gone missing. The Octavas, these were great.
Yeah.
You remember in like Guitar Center, I think they did once like a deal for $150 for a pair.
Yeah, they're not expensive mics at all.
Yeah, they're really good sounding there. Yeah.
And then what's it called? The SM-12,
is it? No.
No, 69.
69, SM-69,
yeah. SM-69 is basically a pair of 87s in one housing.
Beautiful. And your Coles behind.
Yeah. The thing about a small studio is that you got to figure out the best use of space and ways to save space. So I use all kinds of clamps and stuff instead
this
of actual mic
gorgeous.
Stands. Yeah, like
really smart. Yeah.
Like you see in the amp room, like everything's just clamped onto other things. So there's
that's
very
fantastic.
Few stands.
I see the you've got the two mics taped together there.
Again,
451 with a
yeah another Jim Scott trick.
Yeah, I do that on Hat.
Oh really? Two
Dave
mics
Jordan
on the Hat.
Showed me that. Yeah.
Oh cool.
It just EQs itself. It's like, oh, exactly the same,
right,
exactly
yeah.
the same pair.
That's cool.
It's like, oh yeah, that sounds perfect. But that's good. I didn't know
mm-hmm.
Jim did that on the snare.
Mm-hmm. Lots of, it's kind of like, it seemed like an Ocean Way thing, like a lot of setups we would do that.
I'm going to try it.
Yeah.
And then 57 underneath is mm-hmm. like you were saying. There's a good old fashioned Ludwig Superphonic.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful. Just another 451 here.
Yeah.
Great. And what are these?
These are the Heil PR40s.
Oh, right. You were talking about that, didn't you?
Yeah, just a little something different than the usual 421.
Right.
They seem to sound pretty good on the toms. But we were talking about the Vistalite drums.
Yeah.
And, I mean, I was so surprised the first time that someone brought those into a session. I was like, wait, plastic drums? Get out of here.
Yeah.
But it's amazing. They have a sound that no other toms especially make.
I did a video recently, and it was one of my sessions, and all the toms, they were my blue Vistalites.
Yeah, beautiful.
And somebody wrote this, oh, you know, they sound plastic. They do this, they do that. And I said, oh, you know, what do you like the sound of? Oh, I like this, I like that. Mm. And I was like, well, that record was done on a Vistalite, and that record was done.
Yeah.
It's like, they were used so much more prevalently in the 70s than people
I'm
realize.
Sure. Yeah, there's a certain, like, big... like boingy, I don't know. It's just,
they sound huge.
Yeah, and the bigger sizes especially.
Yeah, I mean, close your eyes. I mean, is that wood? Is it plastic? Who knows? It just sounds big.
It just sounds great. Yeah.
Yeah, and a huge kick drum. That's fantastic.
Yeah,
I like the depth. A lot of people forget about that. The depth is really important.
Yeah, this one, it's a Mapex, you know, 20. It's a 24.
Yeah,
and I think is it 18 deep? It's a little deeper than the usual.
It's either 18 or 20.
Be 20.
I'm not very good at that, but that makes a big difference.
But this was brought in by a drummer like 7 or 8 years ago, and it never left. It sounded so good, and it was like...
Did you buy it off him?
I did.
Okay,
Well, first he was like, well, I do need to keep it here. It was Jerry Rowe, fantastic drummer, you know, right. Lives in Nashville now, but he was here and lived in LA for many years. And when he first moved to LA, he needed a place to keep it. So I was like, cool, happy to keep it here. And then the first time he called to take it back, I'm like, no, just tell me how much you want for it.
Nice. Yeah, when you find something that works in the room.
Ah, it just sounds great in this room. Yeah. And we're always putting up other kick drums, and then we're like, I don't know.
It's just so much easier if you can convince the drummer to use your kit. Oh, yeah, it's huge.
Yeah.
Nice. Talk about spank.
Yeah.
A lot of attack on that.
Yeah, it's just really thick and
tons of attack
every time.
What do you got inside?
Just your old standard D112.
D112, yeah.
Yep.
Well, it's great for rock.
Yep.
There's a real revival in the D12s. Simon Phillips uses them, a bunch of people. But
I love those too, yeah.
I love them too, but what I like about the D112 inside is it gives less work to do.
For sure.
It's closer to a rock kit.
It's got a little bit of an EQ on it already.
If you're doing a Kiss record or something like that, that's...
Yeah.
You know, it's the same thing. I had a D112. We didn't use a D112 because the kick we used on the Ace stuff actually didn't. We didn't put a hole in it, but that was a whole other story. But I used a sample of a D112.
There you go.
you have to do what you have to do to make it great.
Yeah.
And then you got the Hammond here.
Yeah. It's an A100, which is very similar, I'm told, to a B3, but it has a few different things about it. One is it has a reverb that has its own speaker. So the reverb, just reverb is coming out of a speaker, which is a really fun thing. You can record just the reverb.
Oh, that's fantastic.
And that's a cool sound on its
own. I didn't know that.
Yeah. And so it's got one speaker, that's the organs coming out, and one that has just the reverb. And then it also has the multi-pin output to go into the Leslie. So I can record, usually what I'll do is record in here, turn the vocal mic on, get the sound of the organ in the room, and have the Leslie. So it adds a whole another little
that's beautiful
kind of vibe to it.
So you have an SM7 here.
Yep.
What's this hiding under here? Is it the Bock?
So that's the Bock 251.
Nice.
Great sounding mic. I put it, you know, I had a, you know, real 251 and some other really great high end mics.
I don't recognize these Yamahas.
Oh yeah, those were my monitors for a long time, and then I just one day woke up and I didn't love them anymore.
I looked at them and I thought, is that some kind of weird Genelec? I thought maybe Genelec.
Yeah, they're kind of like, they were Yamaha's like Genelec
competitors,
killer, yeah. But they're not bad. They make great, you know, live room monitors.
Great.
They're cool.
Yeah. You're a Queen fan, which is fantastic. So
big time, yeah.
Yeah. There's something about Brian May's playing, which is just un-freaking believable.
Yeah, he's like, you know, one of the guitar players that you can tell him immediately just from the sound.
Yeah, you know? I miss a bit of that.
Yeah.
When I worked with Paul Gilbert years ago, what's interesting about Paul, who's such a technical player,
crazy,
and an amazing player, his guitar players he would talk about every day were Neil Sean and Brian May, who were just feel and melody guys, all about melodies. And I really admired that about him, that he wasn't all caught up in all these technical things. And it's almost like you admire the things that maybe aren't your strong suit and you want to get better at, you know.
Yeah.
Which is an interesting question. So for you, what are you sort of, you're still learning. We're always learning doing this.
Mm-hmm.
Is there anything that you're like reaching out for that you're pushing yourself on?
I mean, God, it's so many things.
Good.
Just to, you know, get better at everything that I do, you know.
Yep.
I think I'm learning to not obsess about the smaller things.
Sure.
You know, it's definitely a trait that doesn't help you when you're mixing is to be too obsessive.
Right.
And I find that I'm getting better at sort of letting certain things be what they are and trying to have a big picture perspective.
Sure.
And that to me is, to get to that place is feels really good to not, because there's things that I listen to that I've mixed or worked on, recorded, produced or whatever. And, you know, you hear them back, you go, oh, God. Invariably, it's like the thing that I was obsessed about in a mix, when I listened to it like years later, that aspect of it is like no problem. But there's some other thing that I was totally blind to, you know, that I'd be like, oh, why did I make that choice about that? You know, I was worrying about the way the drum sounded or the kick or something like this. And then meanwhile, there's this like, you know, other aspect of it that I was like, oh.
Yeah.
That could have been better.
I do all the time. I'm like, oh my God, the kick is so loud.
Yeah.
You know. So I come back to some of that stuff.
The people that I, you know, admire when I've been lucky enough to watch them do their thing are the ones who don't kind of like, you know, spend too much time at any particular stage. They just always are moving forward and making decisions and you know,
building on those decisions. You know what I mean?
Sure.
Like Mitchell Froom, going back to the early days when I was working at Ocean Way, I was so excited to assist a session that he was doing. And I was amazed that he, the way he was kind of ruthless with his decisions about what to keep and not to keep, because he always would work on one 24 track tape. Like he would never sync up two machines. Rarely would he like, you know, put something on to a slave and then erase. He would just be like, okay, what are we doing? Okay, background vocals, all right, yeah, cool. Do we need this percussion we did over here? Like, I don't know, we might want it later. Like, no, get rid of it. We'll put the background vocals on that track. You know, just no fear. Just move ahead. Don't think about it, anything, you know, after you've made a decision. So I guess I have made strides towards getting to that kind of, you know, way of doing things, but I can always probably get further.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Well, thanks ever so much for sharing us.
Thank you. It's great having you here. Yeah.
It's a great place. Really, really Cheers. Fantastic place. And I love the way you just utilize everything. I mean, like,
yeah, every corner is kind of like, you know, has been, you know, has something fit into it that's working.
That's working and necessary. Yeah. So thanks ever so much for watching. Please, as ever, subscribe. Go to producelikepro.com, sign up for the email list, and have a marvelous time recording and mixing.